This Is Your Life was a popular TV show in the UK for decades. Like its US, Australian and New Zealand counterparts, the programme chronicled the lives of some of the most famous people in the world, as well as some well-known domestic personalities. It was 1983 when 30-year-old Edwina Boyle, a woman from Cardiff, Wales, but now living in Melbourne, Australia, got a call from the This Is Your Life production company. They wanted her to join them in the filming of an episode featuring her great-uncle George Thomas. The episode featuring the since-disgraced British politician and Member of Parliament was to be filmed and aired in December of 1983, but by the time the filming date came around, Edwina Boyle was nowhere to be found. It was 1970 when 17-year-old shop assistant Edwina Hobbs from Cardiff, Wales, began her new job as a conductor for the Cardiff Bus Company. There she met bus driver Frederick Boyle. A romance blossomed, and 2 years later, on the 26th of February 1972, the now 19-year-old Edwina and 22-year-old Fred were married. They set up home in Peterston-super-Ely, a village 7 miles west of Cardiff City. 4 months later, the couple announced that Edwina was pregnant with their first child. This is when the family of three-to-be emigrated to Dandenong North, Melbourne, Australia, where much of Fred Boyle's family already lived. Their first child, named Carissa, was born 5 months later. They lived in Melbourne, apparently very happy for some years. 1975 saw the birth of Sharon, the Boyle's second baby daughter. Edwina kept in touch with her family back in the UK, writing often about family life, particularly about the lives of their children. By the time 1983 came around, however, things had changed. Fred, now a warehouse manager and carpet fitter, was having an affair with a woman named Virginia Gassara. Gassara, a mother of four, had been a family friend who had got to know the Boyles through their children's mutual love of ice skating. In fact, Carissa Boyle had become a junior ice skating champion of Victoria at the age of 10. It was the 6th of October 1983 when Edwina Boyle disappeared. According to Fred, his wife had left him for a lorry driver named Ray and had moved to Sydney. It was around this time that Virginia Gassara's husband found out about her affair with Fred, and the two had an argument. On October the 7th, the day after Edwina had disappeared, Virginia moved in with Fred and his daughters. Edwina's family on the other side of the world were not informed, at least not at first, and for a family who were used to receiving regular letters from Australia, the sudden halt in communication was worrying. Her sister Valerie said that she had expected Edwina to fly to England for the This Is Your Life episode, but she never made the trip. It was just before Christmas when Valerie received a letter from Fred Boyle, stating that Edwina had left him for another man and had moved away. He added that she should not be surprised if the family did not hear from her at Christmas. Many of Edwina's friends in Melbourne asked after her. All were met with the same story. She had left Fred for another man. Very few, if any, believed that. They knew her to be a dedicated mother and wife who would not leave her children. The night before her disappearance, Edwina was at the skating rink with her daughter Carissa, preparing for an event that was happening in a few days, and one Edwina and her daughters were looking forward to. She had even sewn sequins into a dress for Carissa to wear at the tournament. Edwina's friends also said that she had made efforts to lose weight to, quote, win her husband back from his mistress. Fred, after all, made little effort to hide his affair. But despite some of them going to the police after not seeing her for 6 weeks, Edwina's Melbourne social circle were not taken seriously. Police simply believed Fred's story, and she was not considered a missing person. It wasn't until early 1984, when Edwina's family raised the alarm, that the matter was taken further. Her sister, Valerie Bordley, who lived in Hertfordshire, England, reported the case to Shady Lane Police Station in Watford, who then passed it on through Interpol to Australian authorities. Fred Boyle was then taken in for questioning. Denying any involvement in his wife's disappearance, he repeated that she had left him for another man in the early hours of the 6th of October as he slept. She did not take her car or any of her belongings, but she left a note, he said, although it had since been destroyed. He also suggested that she may now be living under an assumed name. Despite the high level of suspicion surrounding him, Fred was soon released, because there was no actual evidence that foul play was involved, let alone involving him. A Victoria State Government offer of $50,000 for any information on Edwina's whereabouts was offered, but attracted no response. Checks with the Immigration Department showed that she did not leave the country. She did not keep an appointment for a minor medical operation, and she had not turned up to receive her latest paycheck from the chicken farm she had worked at. Over the years, her driver's license and passport were never renewed, and there had been no activity on her bank account. Police at this stage were convinced that Edwina had been murdered. As the years went by and forensic science evolved, police took DNA samples from her sister and used Edwina's dental records to check other unidentified skeletal remains across Australia, but no matches were found. It was 1994 when Edwina's sister Valerie travelled to Melbourne for an inquest into the disappearance. Valerie had not seen Edwina since 1972 and hadn't heard from her since 1983, but by the time Valerie was able to make the 12,000-mile journey with a £2,000 loan she had taken out, it was far from the joyous family reunion she had dreamt of. Also, their mother was very unwell, and it was Valerie's wish to find the answers to the 11-year-old mystery before she passed. The courtroom at the inquest heard from various witnesses. It was quickly realised that, far from planning to run away, Edwina had bought stock in a second-hand shop she wanted to open, and had spoken to friends and family about buying new land to build a new house together. All this with the knowledge that Fred was involved with another woman. As previously mentioned, Edwina's friends told police in the 1980s that she had drastically lost weight, going from size 18 to size 10, according to them, in a bid to win back her husband's affections. When this was raised during the inquest, Fred Boyle retorted, claiming that Edwina was having an affair of her own and had lost the weight to impress her new man. Virginia Gassara's relationship with Fred broke down in 1988. When speaking to police for the inquest in 1994, Virginia herself said that, at first, she was sure Edwina had run away. As time went on, however, her opinion changed. She said, "I honestly believe that she had left Fred. I was aware that Edwina was very close to her daughters, particularly the older one. I thought it strange, being a mother myself, that Edwina would leave her children. I am of the opinion that Edwina is dead. I didn't think that at the time when I went with Fred." Fred Boyle blamed the pressure of the police investigation for the split with Virginia, claiming he had been unfairly singled out as a murder suspect. In a videotaped interview with homicide detectives, he said, "The whole investigation indicated and implies that I have something to hide. I don't bloody like that every day for the last 10 years we have had to live with the possibility that the next knock on the bloody door might be the police coming to pick me up for the murder of my wife. I do not believe the woman is dead. If she is dead, I have nothing to do with it." Fred went on to say that even his daughters believed that their mother was alive. He assured police that one day they would find her alive and well, living under an assumed name. He then went on to give a tirade to the inquest, which included threats to physically harm Edwina if he ever found out where she was, because of the trauma she had put him through. "If I knew where she was, I'd go down there and punch her in the mouth, I bloody would. After living like I have for bloody as long as I have, and putting up with the bloody shit that I think I have every right to be bloody angry." During the inquest, Fred even claimed that he had twice reported his wife missing, and paid for a missing person's notice to be handed out, but there was no police record of such a request ever being made. He also spoke of his fear of capital punishment being reinstated, and said that he might be executed for something he didn't do. Carissa Boyle told police that shortly before her disappearance, her mother said that she would need to go away for a while, and she hoped her daughters would understand. Fred Boyle said that this was a clear indication of her intentions to leave. However, the court was told during the inquest that police suspected very much that Edwina was referring to the This Is Your Life episode, which was filming in late 1983. At the 1994 inquest, Coroner Wendy Wilmoth officially pronounced Edwina Boyle dead, despite there being no trace of a body. In her closing statement to the court, she said, "The length of time which has elapsed since Mrs. Boyle's disappearance, with no contact with her children or family in Britain, makes it extremely unlikely that she is still alive. The weight of evidence suggests the possibility of Mr. Boyle being responsible for her disappearance by taking her life, although there is no direct evidence of his involvement." Wendy Wilmoth went on to say that because of the lack of evidence, no official finding against Fred Boyle could be made. Edwina's sister, Valerie Bordley, headed back to England after the inquest, in debt and none the wiser about what had happened to her beloved sister. Before leaving Australia, she said, "I'm glad I came. I have met some of Edwina's friends, and I am convinced that she would have not disappeared and never contacted her children. I know this is not the end. I believe that one day certain matters will see the light of day, and someone will be charged." Following the inquest, Edwina's family held a memorial service for her back in Wales. They also pressed for an international inquiry and paid for a private detective. Valerie Bordley even hired psychic mediums to find out what had happened. In the end, all lines of inquiry eventually went cold. In 1997, 3 years after the inquest, the Homicide Squad office on the 9th floor of the St Kilda Road Police Headquarters was in need of a little modernisation, which involved the fitting of a new carpet. They called for quotes from various carpet layers in the area. Enter Fred Boyle, who carefully measured the office and floors and gave a quote. He didn't get the job. On the 3rd of October 2006, Fred's son-in-law Michael Hegarty, the husband of his eldest daughter Carissa, undertook a clearance of Fred's house. During the clear-up, he went outside and was faced with a familiar sight, something that had been in and around the house for years. He had first noticed it in 1990, when he and Carissa had started dating, and here it was again, 16 years later, at Fred's new home, in the Carrum Downs area of Melbourne. In fact, the green 44-gallon metal drum had been moved from home to home over the years, from Dandenong North to a caravan park in Narre Warren, to a house in Frankston, and now finally to Carrum Downs. Michael Hegarty often expressed his curiosity and asked Fred what was in the green drum. He was told that it contained glue for carpet fitting. He had always suspected he was being lied to. So on the afternoon of October the 3rd, 2006, he pried the drum open. He found a large amount of women's clothing. Below the pile of clothing, he saw the fabric of what looked like a large Hessian sack. He guessed that the clothing was probably Edwina's, but thought little more of it. That is until 2 weeks later, when he returned to the house and pulled a wheelie bin from the garage. When he opened it, a putrid smell emanated. He reached in and pulled out what he believed to be the same Hessian sack he'd seen in the green drum. Within that sack he felt a slimy substance, but now with suspicions rising he kept going. He pulled out what looked like a human pelvic bone and a leg bone. A number of other bones followed, but finally he found a skull. He called his wife before alerting the police. Police raided Fred Boyle's property. They recovered the rest of the human remains from the Hessian sack, along with more of Edwina's belongings. Fred Boyle was immediately arrested and charged with the murder of his wife. His trial began on January the 31st, 2008, at Victoria's Supreme Court, 16 months after the discovery of what dental records would prove were the skeletal remains of Edwina Boyle. Forensic pathologist Dr. Malcolm Todd concluded that she had died from a single gunshot wound to the right side of the head. Frederick Boyle, now cornered with an irrefutable truth about his wife, changed his story. In his opening statement, he claimed that when he woke up in the early hours of the 6th of October 1983, Edwina was laid next to him naked, covered in blood, with a bullet wound in her head and a tie wrapped around her neck. He said he didn't kill her, but he knew he had to get rid of the body, because he would no doubt be blamed for her murder, especially as he was having an affair. He admitted to falsifying the note he said was left by Edwina, and with no other choice he put her in the Hessian sack and placed her inside the green drum. The following day his brother-in-law visited and Fred showed him the note. His brother-in-law, speaking to the court, confirmed that there had been a note which he believed was written by Edwina. Jane Dixon, Boyle's defence lawyer, attempted to put an argument forward. Yes, she said, Fred had lied for many years regarding his wife's fate, but it didn't mean that he had been responsible. She said, "What is in dispute is that Frederick Boyle killed her. He had no motive to kill his wife, whereas others may have had an opportunity to do so." She suggested that it was the work of a jilted lover, or maybe Edwina was killed by a mysterious intruder. On the 1st of February, the second day of the trial, the eldest Boyle daughter, Carissa, came forward to speak about what her mother told her in 1983 about having to go away for a while. This is interesting because, as I've mentioned previously, in 1994, when the inquest took place, it's on record that police believed it was likely that Edwina was speaking to her then very young daughters about her trip to England for the This Is Your Life episode. In 2008, the now 35-year-old Carissa explained that her mother was tearful when she spoke. It was her opinion that her mother had planned to spend time away from her father due to the strained marriage. Carissa also spoke of the regular arguments her parents had about her father's affair. She said that she didn't know what an affair was back then, but the strain that this new woman had brought on the family was clear. Carissa's now former husband, Michael Hegarty, who had found Edwina's remains, spoke to the court. He said that it gave him chills, but admitted to making a joke in the past about Edwina being inside the drum. There was truth in his jest. He said he'd suspected that's where Edwina was. For 16 years he had held these suspicions. He told the court, "Out of the wheelie bin I pulled what appeared to be a human pelvis and leg bone. I continued to look through the bag and found a skull." Virginia Gisara, Fred's former lover, also spoke at his trial. When questioned about the timing of her move to the Boyle residence, she explained that she had no plans to move in with Fred at all, but following the argument with her husband about the affair, she felt she had to leave the marital home. She said she had nowhere else to turn, but lived day to day concerned that Edwina would return at any moment. "I always thought she would come back," she said. Virginia had satisfied authorities some time ago that she genuinely had no idea where Edwina had gone, and was an innocent party in that respect. She was also asked if she remembered being questioned about the possibility of a connection between Edwina Boyle's disappearance and the presence of a notorious killer who had operated in the area at the time. She said she could not recall being questioned about that. The man in question was Raymond Edmonds, a murderer and serial rapist who was brought to justice in 1986, after 20 years of evading the law. However, Edmonds was never seriously considered as a suspect in Edwina's case, and it's uncertain why police chose to ask Virginia about it. It's interesting that Fred would come up with the name Ray when concocting a story about his wife leaving him for another man. Did he deliberately choose that name in the hope that police would think that Edwina was a victim of Raymond Edmonds, thus getting him off the hook? In regards to Fred's affair, the arguments and the general state of the marriage, a former friend of the Boyles testified that the couple appeared very happy right up until the week before Edwina's disappearance. The unnamed friend said that this is when they babysat the two girls, Carissa and Sharon, so that Edwina and Fred could spend a Saturday night together. When they both came to collect the girls the next day, the friend said that Edwina's neck was covered in love bites. On the 5th of February, 6 days into the trial, Frederick Boyle entered the witness box. He told the court, "I nudged Edwina and she didn't respond. I put the light on and she had been shot through the head and strangled. I went and checked on the girls and was relieved that they were all right. Then I went into the kitchen and cried for hours. I didn't know what to do. I thought, I'm knackered now because I've been having an affair with another woman and no one will believe me." He said he had concocted the story of his wife leaving him for another man and again admitting to writing the note. He went on, "I knew if I contacted the police they would accuse me of killing my wife, so I had lied about it ever since. I have a fairly low opinion of Victoria Police, Obviously, I didn't want to be charged with a murder I didn't commit. I had no way of proving my guilt or innocence. He said that once he had put Edwina in the 44-gallon drum, he placed the drum in the back of his van before later moving it to the back garden. My wife died in a terrible way, he said. I wasn't going to let her be thrown down the tip like some garbage. In response to questions regarding firearms on the property, he admitted owning a gun. He said he had checked to see if the weapon had been used on the night Edwina died, but it had not. Prosecuting lawyer Gavin Silbert suggested to Boyle that he could not have possibly known that his wife had suffered a single shot to the head. Fred Boyle replied that he assumed it was a single shot, but he didn't know for sure. Silbert, at this stage, stated that Boyle had clearly killed his wife. That was the reason the police were not called. It wasn't due to a fear of being blamed for murder or his low opinion of Victoria's police force. It was because he was guilty of her murder. Fred's defence, Jane Dixon, addressed the court. She claimed that Edwina's murder did not have the hallmarks of a domestic murder. She questioned why Fred would kill his wife to be with a woman that he was already having an affair with. It makes no sense at all. There are just too many oddities, too many odd features about this case, and you should not be satisfied that Mr. Boyle murdered his wife, she told the jury. She said that the murder was a mystery. She even went so far as to say, "This is a murder that, at this stage, there is no hope of solving." The prosecution argued that Fred was far from a grief-stricken widower. In fact, he was a pathological liar, who had lied from the beginning, all through the years, and is still lying now in the witness box. The jury agreed. On February the 9th, 2008, they unanimously found Frederick Boyle guilty of the murder of Edwina Boyle. As the guilty verdict was read out, Fred Boyle looked across the courtroom and mouthed consoling words to his eldest daughter, who, along with her sister, had supported their father throughout. During the pre-sentence hearing on February the 29th, Judge John Forrest expressed surprise that Boyle's daughter still supported him, despite it being obvious that he had killed their mother. The prosecuting lawyer, Gavin Silbert, agreed, saying that he found it baffling. Jane Dixon, Fred's defence lawyer, in her closing statement, suggested that Mr. Boyle could easily have got rid of his wife's remains without being caught, but he didn't because he felt that part of him was in that drum with her. She also asked Judge Forrest to take into consideration Fred's ill health when sentencing. He was by now diabetic and partially deaf. The prosecution argued that his health should not be taken into consideration because the delay in him facing justice was his own choosing. Finally, on the 18th of March 2008, Frederick William Boyle, at the age of 58, was jailed for 21 years with no parole for 17 years. Before he handed down the sentence, Justice John Forrest said, "You have sought to live a lie, with the sole aim of avoiding apprehension for your dastardly actions. Rather than admit your wrongdoing, you determined to construct a web of deceit and lies designed to deceive others into believing that the deceased had left you and run off with another man." Edwina's sister, Valerie Bordley, who had attended the trial every day, said, "The worst thing was how she was found. I can't get that out of my head. Justice has been done now, but I just feel so sorry for my nieces. They've lived all these years thinking their mother had deserted them, and now, with this verdict, it's probably going to devastate them." One of the most chilling and often mentioned features of this story are the photographs of people seated around the green drum which once contained Edwina's remains. The photographs were taken on the 19th of February 1993 in the carport of the Boyle home at Carrum Downs. The event marked the 21st birthday of Michael Hegarty, the then future son-in-law of Fred Boyle. Mr. Hegarty identified his cousin and her boyfriend posing in one image. Another showed a friend and his uncle, and a third photograph showed Hegarty's auntie sitting on the lap of her boyfriend as they smiled at the camera. The green 44-gallon drum containing Edwina Boyle features prominently in each shot.